Well, the good news and the bad news today. The good news is that God has the medicine you need for your ills. Bad news is it tastes bad sometimes. You know, it's like you get a flu shot, and they say that that can sort of make you sick, but not as sick as you would get if you really got the flu. Jesus cleanses the temple. It's a healing, but it didn't mean that it was an easy day for anybody. So the good news is that Jesus is the antibiotic for your infection. But Richard Rohr said, before the truth sets you free, it tends to make you miserable. And so this is why sometimes after a sermon, someone will say, oh, that was a great sermon, Pastor Ed, and I go, thank you. And that's nice. And then sometimes someone will say, not that I didn't enjoy it, but I was miserable, or it made me miserable. Think of that. And say, well, then I should say, thank you. Wouldn't that be something? Because if I'm only saying things to you that you like to hear, it's like a coach that never tells you when you're doing something that's not swinging right, you know, that's teaching, you know, 2 + 2 = 5, and you have to say, you're a very wonderful child, but no, around here, 2 + 2 = 4, and see how it goes. And so there's parts of the gospel that are non-negotiable, that we need to stand up for, whether people like it or not. The nice thing about this is today's is still kind of safe, I think, because we can always say, well, that was a long time ago when Jesus did this. Listen to the story. This is from the Gospel of John, the cleansing of the temple. And instead of the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, that happened right before the crucifixion at the end of his ministry, this happens in the beginning of his ministry, all the way in John chapter 2 in the very beginning. And if you look at the picture that's on the wall, I can tell you that this is a picture of Jesus cleansing the temple according to the Gospel of John. How can I tell? Because Sherlock Holmes up here knows that it's only the Gospel of John that has Jesus with a cord in his hands. The other ones don't have that little detail in there. And so this is always an issue. Like, why did Jesus do that? Why isn't that in Matthew, Mark, and Luke? And why is that in John? Why is he trying to say that? Why does John have it at a different place? And why does John dress it up a little bit differently? So, something to think about. But Linda, who does these, you just got the Gospel of John? I think you got that right, huh? You knew that. Yeah, that's right. If you look cleansing the temple, it's sometimes he may not have that in his hands. Here's the story. Remember, when this was written by the author to Christians who were probably not Jews, who were Gentile believers in the area, which is why he will say things like the religion of the Jews or the Passover of the Jews, like they don't understand these things. It's because they didn't. And so remember, Jesus was a Jew, Mary was a Jew, Peter was a Jew, all the apostles were Jewish. So I just want you to remember that. But the early church, many of them, in the beginning, though they were Jewish, they became to be Gentile believers, people who were not Jewish. So by the time John was written, he's talking to these people like they don't know what's going on when it comes to the Jewish faith, because they don't. And so when you hear that, it might be a bit striking, but you need to understand that it was written for people who did not see themselves as being Jewish, but saw themselves as being followers of Jesus. So here's what it says. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews then said to him, what sign can you show us for doing this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, this temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus has spoken. Now, one reason why Jesus could do this cleansing of the temple and not be crucified right away was because there was a respect that the Jewish community had for prophets. People could, you know, wear funny clothes and do street theater and say, you know, God's going to do something horrible to you and then you're going to get it, or God's going to do something wonderful and you're going to be blessed. And they would, there was a whole bunch of them out there. And how could you tell who God was speaking through and who wasn't? So they kind of had a hands-off policy. It's kind of like it is in the state of Ohio when it comes to being clergy and doing weddings. You can get your online degree and for what, $10 to $15, and you can do a wedding in the state of Ohio, because the state of Ohio doesn't decide what a real religion is and what isn't. So if you belong to some religion, it doesn't matter if it started yesterday, they'll sign you up to do a wedding in Ohio, because again, how are they going to do it? And so the ancient Jewish people, in the same way, they say, how can we tell who's a real prophet and who isn't? So when somebody did something like maybe Jesus in the temple, they would say, well, you know, God people can be really strange sometimes, so let's just kind of leave him alone. So it's possible. It's possible. But the other Gospels have him doing it at the end of his ministry and leading immediately to his betrayal, because that's when he got down to the belly of the beast. He said the words that couldn't be said. He did the things that couldn't be done. He went after the things that they held sacred, and that was enough. And his organization had been infiltrated by Judas. He had a paid informant, Judas. He was betrayed by Judas. He was arrested at night. He was tortured. He was killed, as happened so many times in history to those who want to take on the powers. So, but John is different. I want you to understand, rather than getting hung up on, why does John have it at a completely different place? Why is John completely different than the other Gospels? I want you to understand why John is different. It's because John is telling a story of the soul's journey to God with Jesus. He's not necessarily telling a direct historical story of how Jesus' life was, which is more like Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But he's telling a story of what it's like to be drawing close to God in Jesus. Let me explain. The first story in John is the wedding feast, the water to wine. And this is the discussion of when you give your life to God. When you give your life to God, it is like new wine. It is beautiful. I tell you, I had this experience when I gave my life to God, which I really did a bunch of times, right? I couldn't just stop with one. I have to do it a lot because I keep taking it back. But there were times that were significant. And one of those significant times really meant a lot to me when I was about early in college. I was a young man, I was sincere, and I was a wreck. I mean, I just felt like I wasn't going real well with my life, and I did the thing where I said, And I gave my life to God through Jesus. So the way I did it was I said, Jesus, take this life of mine, please. I'm not doing very well with it. Just make me what you want. There you are. I'm done. Please, please do something with me. That's kind of how I was at that moment. And so my turning the water to wine experience was that I really meant it. I was sincere. I had a prayer. I said, God, please give me something to do, and that prayer was answered the next morning. But the other thing was that it was on a Saturday night, and the next morning it was time to go to church. And I don't remember anything about church that morning, okay? So it wasn't like I went to church and it was like water turned to wine. But it was my experience was like the tree was more of a tree than it had ever been before. You know what I'm saying? The grass was more alive than it had ever been before. It's like when I stepped out that front door the next morning, it was like the whole world was alive in a way that had never been alive before. What had happened is I had become alive in a way that I hadn't been before. And this is the new wine. And this is the experience of transformation that happens when we surrender our lives to God. But then next comes the story of Jesus cleansing the temple, the purification. Because the next thing that often happens in your life is there's things you really do need to give up and change. You just can't keep living the way you lived before. In my case, being a kid in the 1970s, you know, when everyone was trying booze and weed, right? I don't know, that, so was I. And I had to give that up. So it's like all the friends that I hung out with, that's what they wanted to do. They wanted to say, dude, I was so wasted. We had such a great weekend. I don't remember it at all. Right? And it was like, that was kind of stupid. But that's what people did that day. Maybe it's different now. But in the 1970s, in the outside of Philadelphia, that's the way it was. And that's the group that I was kind of, and so when I gave my life to Jesus, the purification had to come. I had to say to my friends, no, I'm not going to go out and party with you anymore. And I like sort of like lost all my friends except like one. It's okay. It's okay. A purification comes. And then, in case you want to keep going with the soul's journey, so the wedding, the purification, then it has the nighttime prayer. A man comes to Jesus at night, Nicodemus, and Jesus says, you have to be born again, which is a woman's image. So he tells a man, it's a man, a woman's image in the dark. And the next story is about a woman who comes to him at noon. He says, the living waters, the fountain of living waters, an active masculine image in the day. So a man comes to Jesus in the dark and gets given the woman's image of being born again. A woman comes to Jesus at noon and he gives him the man's image of the outgoing fountain of living water. And so this Gospel of John is deep. And then after that comes a healing. And so I'm telling you, if you want to understand the Gospel of John and what this story of cleansing the temple is about, it's about the wedding, then the purification, then the being born again, then the fountain of living water, then the healing. It's a soul's journey in God. So in a way, it's like a pilgrim's progress here in the Gospel of John. And so that's what it's about. You get it? Is that okay with you? If you want to try to make the Gospels fit together and kind of jam them together, you can do that. But I think it's a lot easier to say John was after something different and to hear it with your own soul and understand that John is talking about all of us in our journey together into God. All souls go through this. And what is the journey point? It is that cleansing must come. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God, or the realm of God. The poor in spirit, the poor have nothing to give God. And God loves that because they're honest. Thomas Merton called it one of the gifts of the Spirit is indigence, the recognition of your own indigence, which is a way of saying your poverty. That in the end we have nothing to offer God. In other words, what can we give God that God hasn't first given us? We really all we can say is thank you. But we can't have the art of the deal with God. You can't manipulate God. You can't merchandise God. And so the difficulty in the temple in this story is different than Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, he could be talking about women. That women had to pray out where the cattle were, and there was no space for them to pray because that's where they were selling the sheep and changing the money. And Jesus said, get out of here! The women need a place to pray too, because the men could go into the high holy place. Not the super high holy place for the high priest, but you know, a place where the men could go. And it's like, and for the Gentiles. So the women and Gentiles kind of were like second class, but it's at least give them a nice room. It's like if you had a nursery, and it's at least keep the nursery clean, you know, it's like, make it nice. And so that's one possible meaning. And Jesus also talked about he called it a den of thieves, and he said, my house shall be a house of prayer for all people. And so that was the meaning in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But here in John, he says it's a place of, you've turned it into a place of merchandise. And so since John is talking about the soul's journey to God, I think it's how we try to manipulate God or put things between us and God, or we, particularly in religious leadership, might try to put something between you and God. Look at it this way. Nobody should have to pay anything or sacrifice any animal in order to pray and be forgiven. If religion were a thing that money could buy, the rich would live and the poor would die, was the old song. And the idea was that the rich could buy an ox, and maybe that would impress God a lot. And if you weren't quite so rich, you could buy a sheep, and maybe God would be okay with that. If you were poor, you had to buy a dove, and that was, I guess, it'll have to do. And if you gave some money, it couldn't be dirty Roman money. It had to be nice, clean Jewish money, so they would change it a little bit, you know, to take care of business. And so that's the way it went at the temple. And Jesus saw this as a merchandising, as a putting something between the people and God that didn't need to be there. So please understand that if you never give a dime and don't have a dime, that's okay with God. All the dimes are God's anyway. There's nothing you can give to God. There's nothing you need to give to God. All we can really just give is ourselves, and let that be what it is. Our talents, our gifts, our money, our jobs, our health, all those things are first of all something we receive. They're not really something we can leverage on God. And when we catch ourselves out trying to make deals with God, like if I give this, you give me that, you know, we'll make a deal. And God often answers our prayers, and we do or do not keep our part. But the point is, from Jesus, we need to get away from that. And he would drive that out of our souls. He would drive that out of our souls. The idea that we can corner God and we can merchandise God. So that's one of the meanings of the story. And that is that there's nothing that you have to pay, and there's nothing you can give to God in a way, because God already has it. Just give yourself. And the other thing is, it's part of this spiritual pathway, which is learning to see yourself as you really are. We had a young man years ago come into our chess club, and he said, I'm going to be the next world champion. And so they said, Ed, you play him. Put that guy down. No world champion today for you. It's humbling. He probably beat his sister a bunch of times in chess, or his brother, or his mom. And he came to the chess club and thought he was a real chess player. I was kind of like that too. I hadn't lost a game in years. I came to Toledo and I lost 3 games in a row. I was like, well, there's a lesson for you, Ed. You aren't as good as you thought you were. It's humbling, but it's necessary. It's seeing ourselves as we really are. It's a humble path to follow God, because we're not as loving as we should be. We're not as gracious as we should be. We're not as together as we should be. We're not as generous as we should be. There's a lot of places where we're just really not as we should be. And if we compare ourselves to each other, we can say, well, at least I give as much as him, or I'm as generous as him, or at least I'm not like that person. But we don't get to compare ourselves with each other. We get to compare ourselves in the eyes of Jesus Christ. And sometimes that can be like a whip of cords. All of our sacrifices, our sheep and our oxen and our money, and Jesus just throws that stuff over and it's like, no, you don't come to God like that. So Richard Rohr, I don't know if I have the courage to pray this, but this is his thing about this path down in humility. He says, I have prayed for years for one good humiliation a day, and then I must watch my reaction to it. I have no other way of spotting both my denied shadow self and my idealized persona. Any of you want to try that prayer, be my guest. Let me know how it goes. Oh, I don't know if I have the courage to pray that prayer. But I've had my humiliations without praying that prayer. I have said things and done things, and I go home and I think, oh, Ed, how could you have said such a stupid, stupid thing? Did you ever do that? I do that. How could you have done that? And sometimes, it's like, they're going to misunderstand me. I didn't mean it like that. And so brothers and sisters, be merciful to some of these politicians. Maybe be merciful to all the politicians. Imagine if you had the news in your face every minute of the day. You have to be on point. You can't say, oh, poop once. Because it's going to be out there in the whole world. You can't tell the dog, get out of my way, or the SPCA will be after you. The point is, they're after you. The dog is good. The saying is, if you want a friend in Washington, get a dog. So I'm just saying that our humiliations, our mistakes, can be lessons in awareness for us if we can learn from them. It's like take advantage of your learning opportunities. Don't let them go to waste. I think that's what Richard Rohr means. The soul's journey to God has purgation, to cleansing and illumination, kenosis, emptying, entheosis, filling, the cross and resurrection, surrender and glory, shame and healing, breaking and fixing. It's all part of the path. And I'm telling you, if there is no kenosis, there's no theosis, no cross, no resurrection. Jesus says, if anyone wants to be my disciple, let them deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. Whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. Whoever would lose his life for my sake will find it. This is a deep teaching about surrender. And it's a path down to go up. It seems odd, but sometimes deep things are exactly like that. Well, this is exactly like that. So Jesus will cleanse your temple, my sisters and brothers, and you may not enjoy it, but you need it. And a way to think about it again would be the Heimlich maneuver. So the Heimlich maneuver, so from my Boy Scout days, is you're sitting at the restaurant and you've got your Do a Good Deed Daily Boy Scout badge on and you're prepared, and you see a person go, we were told in the Boy Scouts, the universal signal for I'm choking. Who remembers that? They go like, yeah, that's right. But who when you're choking, remembers to go like, oh, I will now give the universal signal for I'm choking. They probably just like, who knows what they do? But they're going to turn a color, right? And they're going to start to pass out. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been in a place where it's happened? I have once. Not a whole lot. And I wasn't the guy to rush in there and do the maneuver. It was somebody else. But they did that thing where you get behind them, reach your hands around them, and you pull that up into their solar plexus, I guess, and they go, and they cough out that thing that they needed to get out so they can breathe again and live. We are minutes away from death any time, aren't we? Minutes away from death any time. And the thing about the Heimlich maneuver is, if you have nobody there, you're supposed to throw yourself over the back of a chair and try to do it to yourself. The point is, sometimes it takes somebody else to get that blockage out. So I'm saying, you're the temple. You've got this thing clotting up your spiritual life. Jesus, you're going, you thought it was a good thing. It looked like a nice piece of meat. It's delicious, well-seasoned. This is going to be great. Next thing you know, it's what's going to kill you. and it's not so great anymore, Jesus comes around and goes, and you're better. And so it's a bad thing, it's a good thing. It's a bad thing, it's a good thing. The very thing that you thought was going to be delicious, this great big temple, all these great sacrifices, all these traditions, turned out to be something that was actually choking you off and stopping you from breathing. And Jesus comes into that temple, comes into your soul, finds that thing that is blocking you, and gets it out of there. And you don't enjoy it. Or you do. But I tell you what, that later on you're better, because otherwise you're dead. So imagine for a minute. So after Jesus cleanses the temple, the money changers pick up their money, and the sheep herders reherd their sheep, and the oxen people, and business goes on as usual, and that night they go home. How was work today, dear? Oh, it was rough. Some guy came in and told us that we were merchandising and threw everything over. It was terrible. And one of them goes to bed and goes, glad he left. Another person goes home and goes, I wonder if he was right. Maybe I should take up another line of business. You know, imagine. And so it's a question. Do you want Jesus to give you the Heimlich maneuver if you're choking? Do you want Jesus to cleanse your temple? Or have you been working at it for 47 years and you don't want to change now? It's hard to say, I've been working on this a long time and I was wrong. They say the first rule of getting out of a hole is stop digging. And so this is a spiritual teaching from John, as well as a social justice teaching, but the spiritual teaching is that the life with God is not always easy. After the wedding, there's the cleansing. There's the nighttime prayer of new birth. There's the daytime prayer of flowing waters. And there's the healing. This is all part of your journey. But we need to accept every single part of it to walk the path. You just can't be skipping steps because your legs aren't long enough. And so we do go through these steps as people of God. So I want you to know this. It's not about selling Girl Scout cookies in church. Girl Scout cookies in church are actually perfectly fine. Now, if you said you have to buy a Girl Scout cookie in order to pray to God and get forgiveness, then it would be wrong. But that's not what it is. Doris Fowler used to come here and do the Alzheimer's walk. And people would say, you shouldn't be doing the Alzheimer's walk in church. Or it's too busy, we're asking for money too many times. But again, there's nothing wrong with Doris Fowler, may she rest in peace, doing the Alzheimer's walk. What would be wrong is if you said, if you didn't give money to the Alzheimer's walk, then you couldn't pray and you couldn't come to God and you couldn't take communion or something like that. The merchandising is when you require people to pay something in order to get God's grace. There is nothing that you can do to get God's grace. God's grace comes by God's love. And so it may feel like a stinging. Your plots and plans are overturned. But the good news is you're healed. You're healed. You didn't even know you were sick. You thought you were all right. But after Jesus came, you discovered you were sick. But oh, you feel so good now. That's what the cleansing of the temple is about. The medicine of God in Jesus Christ, coming from outside of us and in us and through us. So in some ways, as we take communion, think about that as well. As we say the body of Christ, the blood of Christ, we think of Jesus Christ as divine medicine in a way. So symbolizing Jesus coming into us. But remember, he's a cleanup man.